Hi, my name is Jay Doya. This is a lecture about insulation materials in the context of the Erasmus renovation project in Austria. What is an insulator? An insulator is a material with a thermal conductivity below 0.1 watt per meter per Kelvin or degree. Good insulators, we see the thermal conductivity is between 0.03 and 0.05, and extremely well insulators are lower than these values. Since there's an ongoing focus on energy efficiency, there's also a growing focus on insulating materials and this new materials on the market. In this lecture will briefly describe the different types available and their applications. When we pick our type of insulation material, we do this by the properties we desire and of course the budget we have. Here's eight major properties for insulation. The list can, of course, be longer. Thermal conductivity, obvious. Compressive strength, when relevant, for example, under a ground force lab. Specific heat capacity, the ability of a material to absorb heat. A high heat capacity can have a positive influence on the inner climate in lightweight structures. Reaction to fire, is it combustible or is it unburnable? Do we need to pack the insulation with fire insulation? The water vapor diffusion resistance, does the insulation function as a damp-proof membrane or should it function as a damp-proof membrane? Long-term water absorption, very relevant for insulation you use in the soil or in bathrooms. Maximum surface temperature and sound impedance. We can classify insulation or in inorganic and organic, and in this case new developments. As you can see at the bottom, these are the figures from Germany in 2010. The inorganic mineral wools have about 50% of the market, and after that there comes the synthetic organic foams, and followed by less than 10% others. If you start with the inorganic materials, the synthetic inorganic materials, we have the usual suspects, the mineral wools, glass wool and rock wool. We have cellular glass, calcium silicate foam material, and on the high end we have aerogel. Mineral wool, nice all-rounder with a good thermal conductivity, resistant to mold, but that's almost all the inorganic materials. Very good fire proportions, good sound proportions, flexible, it can be fitted in between rafters. You can get it in a good compressive strength if needed. On the downside, it can be noted that most parts of it will end up in a landfill, though it is recyclable, reusable, or partly recyclable. The big advantage is, of course, that it's relatively cheap. Cellular glass. Good thermal conductivity. Inert and extremely durable, it's virtually indestructible. It doesn't react with anything, doesn't burn, it has an infinite water vapor diffusion resistance. Water has no effect on it, basically. It's a very good compressive strength, but it's brittle. But it's excellent as a cold bridge break in masonry or in parapets. It's also very good in, for example, soil or roof tears because it doesn't react with anything. It is reusable, primarily as road fill, but not when it's glued, and in most cases it will be glued. On the downside is the is that it's very expensive. On the high end of the spectrum, we have aerogel, which has an extremely good thermal conductivity of down to all 17. It's extremely lightweight, about 60 or to 80 kilo per cubic meter. It doesn't react, and it's stable. And it can be used in transparent solutions, for example, in filling in some kind of glass. On the downside is, again, that it's very, very expensive. Then we move to inorganic materials, the natural ones. We have the range of expanded clays, and on the right you see expanded clay. The brand name in Denmark is Leica. Thermal conductivity is not impressive, but the material is very strong, has a good compressive strength, it is incombustible and does not rot, and this makes excellent foundation if you bind them together. Here you see a Danish Leica therm block, which has like an extra thermal break in the middle of polystyrene. Then we move to the organic ones, the synthetic ones, basically all foam types. Most of them are derived from crude oil, but actually they can be made of organic materials as mice or other agriculture products. Polystyrene expanded, polystyrene extruded, polyurethane rigid foam, phenolic foam, melamine foam, and polyethylene foam. I will discuss the first four. EPS extruded polystyrene, naphtha between 0032 and 0040. That's nice. Resistant to molds, doesn't rot, not hygroscopic. Fire is Euroclass E. Can't be used with hot bitumen, or not directly on the roof. Good compressive strength and partly recyclable. You can crush it and reform it into packaging material, for example. Relatively cheap. It's a broader extruded polystyrene. Same thermal conductivity, a little bit better. Also resistant to mold and doesn't rot. Same fire glass. It has no water absorption whatsoever, which makes it very suitable for in soil insulation or roof terraces. Good compressive strength and also theoretically reusable. A little bit more expensive than the expanded polystyrene, about 30% more. Polyurethane rigid foam, the PUR and the PIR foams, it's actually the same family. The PIR has a little bit better fire properties. Good thermal conductivity, resistant to molds and solvents. Traditionally, it's used in sandwich panels, as we see here. Cooling boxes and so on. A little bit better fire properties. Completely vapor tight, So, mind the technical detailing, considering a double tamper-proof membrane, for example. That's a bad idea. It has a very low water absorption and high compressive strength, and it can be partly reused, if not glued to another structure. PF foam has a lot of the same properties as the PIR and the PUR, but even better fire class. It's almost impossible to ignite, and that's why it ends at Euro class C. It's a brittle material, and it's often used as insulation material for piping. Then we move to the organic ones, natural organic ones, wood, wool, cork, cellulose, or paper fibers, hemp, reeds, cocoon fibers, and straw bales, and so on and so on. I'll focus on the three most used organic fiber materials. Wood wool. They can be pressed in beds, as we see on the picture in the bottom, or can be used as loose material that is injected in the cavity wall. The thermal conductivity is a little bit swinging depending on the density of the material. PIR is a Euro class E, needs boric acid to obtain it. It is very diffusion open. Which makes it excellent in renovation projects where there's no or a failing damp-proof membrane because the damp can travel through the material if necessary. It's very good sound properties and is partly reusable. Boric acid is the problem, I guess. It's very nice material to work with. It doesn't itch as the mineral wools. Cork has a good thermal conductivity. These plating materials are binded by a natural binder that's in the material itself. Materials diffusion open has good sound properties but needs a flame retarder. It's limited stock. Almost all production is in Europe, in Portugal and Spain. So it is not endless, infinite, which is a big disadvantage, and it's relatively expensive. Cellulose, paper, fibers, good thermal conductivity. As with wood fibers, it needs boric salts to obtain a Euro class E fire class. Diffusion open has good sound properties, and because of the salts, it's very hard to recycle. On the right side, you see a typical use of cellulose fibers on as an attic insulation. New developments. There's a lot of new developments going on. I think the last two on this list are the most interesting. The cell size of foam material has a considerable influence on the insulating properties. So if you can make it smaller and smaller, the heat transfer will be lower and lower. The heat transfer by convection, that is. So theoretically, these nanocellular foams, they can come down to a thermal conductivity that is about 0.004 or even lower. Vacuum insulation panels, extremely low thermal conductivity. It's basically an insulating element. It comes in fixed size. You cannot adjust it. It consists of a gas-tight enclosure with a rigid core from which the air has been evacuated. Of course, in time the vacuum will disappear, but manufacturers claim that even if the element gets punctured, it will still have a lambda of 0.02, so it will still have an excellent insulating failure. They are 100% vapor tight, and they are extremely expensive. So this is a high-end solution. Applications. There's a very handy German norm, DIN 4108, German norm for standardized insulation materials in their field of applications. It will describe the principal use of insulation in three categories: suspended floors and roofs, walls and basements, external use of insulation. And then it redefines these three groups into 17 possible applications. It's very handy because it has a matrix inside that puts all the materials and the applications on two axes, and from that matrix you can either choose your insulation out of properties, or you can pick your insulation material and see where you can use it. This is an example for cellular glass, where it has also a graphical representation of the application. Point of focus, cold bridges. Cold bridge is a thermal bridge, locally higher heat transfer through the construction. Of course, we lose energy through the construction that way where we have a cold bridge, but there's also a risk for condensation in a cold bridge and potential problems with mold and rots and so on and so on. Typically, cold bridges are caused by a change in building material, for example, a steel column in a masonry. That for the static support is there. It's the building geometry itself that makes the cold bridge, corners, windows, and so on, or built-in items as, for example, steel anchors that go through the construction are cold bridges. And depending on the nature of cold bridges, we distinguish linear or point thermal bridges or cold bridges. Avoiding cold bridges. Primary strategy: a continuous layer of insulation around the warm building volume. Basically, pack the volume with a coat, a continuous coat. This is not always possible, especially with refurbishment. Then we have to think of other solutions, and the best solution then will be to pack the elements on both sides. External elements should be free from the existing structure. For example, balconies, they can have their own column structure outside of the building and can be completely freestanding. If this is not possible, of course, we need to make a thermal break between the elements. This thermal break should also be in small parts and detailing. For example, if fixings can have a little plastic expansion part in the middle, then we can avoid the cold bridge with that. Note the thing in the bottom: not all cold bridges can be avoided, especially in refurbishment. And we should always be critical about economic consequences as well. Sometimes it's perfectly acceptable to have a cold bridge in a balcony, for example. If there's not a big risk for damage in the construction, Avoiding core breaches, the strategy of packing the construction with a continuous layer. This is a foundation or a wall detail, where we have maybe a mineral on the outside wall, and maybe a polystyrene underneath the flooring, and then a little block of cellular foam underneath the load bearing in the slab. And then we have a continuous layer where we separate cold from the warm. The same principle goes for a wall roof detail here. A continuous layer of outside insulation. Parapets, very simple detail actually. The roof is just lying on top of it and then just wraps with the insulation material. A sample of a refurbishment of a basement, maybe, where it was not possible to make a continuous layer on the outside. So here there's actually the outside wall, the outside basement wall is packed on both sides, and then of course the bigger the overlap, the lower the heat transfer will be. Passive house standards, air tightness of 0.6 cubic meter per square meter per hour. This is relevant, of course, because of the bigger air tightness will have a great positive effect of heat exchange. Space heat requirements should be energy use should be below 15 kilowatt hours per square meter annually. Building fabric U value should be below 0.15 watt per square meter Kelvin, and the U value for the windows should be lower than 0.8 watt per square meter per Kelvin. There's some potential problems in the passive house standards, and we should be aware of this. Mainly overheating has been a big problem in passive housing because of the thick isolation layer. Because of the thick walls, there will be less light inside. This doesn't have to be a problem, but it is a design parameter you should take in consideration. Of course, the gross area will be less as well. Because of the isolation in the facade, there's a potential risk for example, rainwater will not vaporize this fast in the autumn and in winter because the facade is so cold, and there's maybe a potential risk for frost damage. So take this in consideration. Refurbishment strategies. Shall we insulate externally or internally? Well, we already discussed the cold breaches, and of course, from a cold breach point of view, it's a good idea to have external wall insulation because they will be limited, and also the dew point will be moved outwards, so there's less risk for condensation in the construction. Thermal mass is also activated because it's on the inside. Insulation, the rendering and cladding, with the rendering and cladding can also be used as a weather protection and finishing. It basically covers the whole facade, and this can be an economic advantage, especially when the facade was bad. Theoretically, it's possible to install an insulation without moving the occupants, though it's often not preferable, but it has been done before. Contra, of course, the building will change character dramatically. So that is not always possible or desired. And of course, the finishing must be robust because the insulation, well, is now your rain shields and your primary facade. Internal wall insulation. Possible for listed buildings, and therefore also sometimes the only solution, because it's the only thing you're allowed to do. It's in general a little bit cheaper, and it is less depending on weather conditions. Contra, all the wiring has to be relocated, of course, because you are building up on the inside. There's risk for cold breaches and thereby also risk for molds and rots on the inside, which makes it even more risky.